It all starts with the question, what even is information? My name's Peter, and this is Stacks and Facts. Maybe it feels like a simple question, but what actually is information? Is it the YouTube video you watch to learn about music theory? Is it the book you read in your free time, or the podcast you listen to on the bus to work? Or are these simply a medium for something else? As it happens, there's no consensus across disciplines about what information actually is, and even within the field of LIS itself, there's no single definition that people point to, but there are lots of them, link in the doobly-doo. That's due in no small part to the fact that how a mathematician thinks of information can be wildly different from, say, a wildlife biologist, whose definition is different still from a poet's, and so on and so forth, ad nauseum, forever and ever. Amen. But if we're going to talk about information science and the various information professions, then we have to give this question some thought. What we think information is and isn't shapes how we study and interact with it. So that's what we're looking at today. Now, let's begin with one of the great philosophers of our time.
Today, we're going to tell you about a word called information, right? Information. And information mean news or facts about something.
Did you catch that? News or facts about something. Now, let's see how this cookie crumbles. Okay, not this cookie. We're gonna see how this cookie fits into my face. First, there's the idea of truthfulness. Information is factual. If I tell you that this is a cookie, that's information. If I tell you it's cake, that's misinformation, or at least about this cookie. It might inform you about something else, but within the context of this cookie, it's not relevant. This leads us to aboutness. Information tells us about something else. If I just sat here and said dog, magenta, Charlie Hebdo, chrysanthemum, flummox, or whatever, that wouldn't be information, it would be noise, random fluctuations that obscure or do not contain meaningful data. Finally, we have thingness, and information is a thing, albeit perhaps intangible. After all, news is a thing, and facts are things, right? They're just separate from the books and newspapers that hold them. And if we look at the roots of the word itself, we can see that this part of the definition is baked in. The prefix in means within, like in the brain or mind, and formare means to create, or take shape, or to form. Now, let's go back to Cookie Monster for a second.
Today, we're going to give you information about word cookie. Give me cookie, please. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Right in my hand. Oh, thank you. That cookie. And now let me give you information about cookie. And the information is cookie was delicious. Give me other cookie, please. Other cookie. Oh, thank you, thank you. Now let me give you more information. Cookie was delicious and crunchy. Now give me a whole box, please. Whole box. Oh boy. Oh boy. Oh, thank you very much, Tara. Now rest of information. Cookies gone. Ha ha ha. Thank you, Tara. Give me a hug. Oh, thank you.
When Cookie Monster tells us that cookies are delicious, crunchy, and ultimately gone, it allows us to build in our own brains an idea of what those cookies are. At this point, the information about cookies transforms into knowledge about cookies, and this knowledge in turn will shape our future encounters with and perceptions of cookies as things. This way of thinking about information follows what's known as the data, information, knowledge, wisdom, or more simply, DIKW pyramid. The idea behind the DIKW pyramid is that concepts of things follow a path from least processed, like data, to most processed, like wisdom. It's an easy rabbit hole to fall into, but the basic idea is that if information were a cookie, then its ingredients would be the data that go into it, and how it tasted would be the knowledge that derives from it. Now, as for wisdom, that would probably be more along the lines of, say, whether or not a person decided the cookie tasted good or not. But that's outside of the scope of LIS, so we're not going to touch on that a whole lot. So let's move on. Now, Claude Shannon is one of the pioneers of information theory, which is a field of study separate from but related to LIS that looks at the engineering around signaling, that is, sending ones and zeros, radio waves, beams of light, and all that jazz. Shannon saw information as a thing to build systems around. He worked at Bell Labs during World War II, and like many of his contemporaries, his research initially revolved around wartime communications between entities and the systems that made this possible. The entities could be people, or they could be systems like radar or fire control. In 1948, his article A Mathematical Theory of Communication was published, which laid the groundwork for information theory as a field. We can get an idea of how it framed information from its introduction. The fundamental problem of communication is that of reproducing at one point, either exactly or approximately, a message, selected at another point. Frequently, the messages have meaning, that is, they refer to, or are correlated according to, some system with certain physical or conceptual entities. In other words, information is a thing that conveys meaning about stuff. Sound familiar? That gets transmitted as a message from one place to another. When we think of it this way, information becomes somewhat defined by the fact that it has a sender and a receiver, and is sent along a medium or a channel, whether that's electrons in a wire, or light through fiber optics, or radio waves through space-time. The medium may introduce interference or degradation to the message itself. You could call this interference noise like I did earlier, or entropy, which is the word that Shannon borrowed for it from physics. Shannon's model also has an encoder and a decoder. These turn the information into something that can be sent on whatever medium, say zeros and ones, and then decoded and understood by the recipient, say words or coordinates. So that's Shannon's idea of information, a thing to build systems around. But there's a much more elegant definition of information that often gets attributed to him, although I haven't found a source for it. Stand by, if I find one, I'll let you know. And at least philosophically, I think it contributes to our understanding. Information, he said, supposedly, is the resolution of uncertainty. Finally, let's talk about Professor Robert Losee out at UNC Chapel Hill. In his search for a definition that exists that can apply regardless of the discipline that one looks at, he gives us the idea of information from process. More specifically, information as the characteristics of a process's output that inform about the process itself. That process could be writing a book, or baking cookies, calculating pi, or looking at the stars. An interesting thing about this definition is that it pulls the definition away from being necessarily human-sourced. Losee spends an entire page discussing how a kitten's purr, for example, can produce many kinds of different information, depending on the lens through which one considers it. Maybe there's a place in LIS for a definition like this. It could give us the flexibility we need to cross the lines between computer science and psychology, or education and digital media, or user experience and social justice. But to be clear, Losee's idea is not as yet the information science definition. Such a definition does not exist. And that's okay. Because LIS pulls from so many different fields, I think that there's something to be said for having some wiggle room in how information is described. My Chinese teachers always told me, "Gunju sheng xiao wen jiao yizi," which means find meaning according to context. And when we're looking at Dr. Bates's world of recorded information produced by human agency, the context matters. A lot. So that's just a few ideas of what information is, but there are tons more out there. If you want to see some of them, for example, go into the doobly-doo and you'll see a link to the entry on information from the Information Science Encyclopedia, written by our very own Dr. Bates, who I mentioned last video. Dr. Bates, you are getting so much coverage. Good on you. But I'm more curious to see how y'all decide to define information for yourself, whether that's for your studies or your work, or your life more broadly. Let me know in the comments below, or shoot me a tweet, @StacksAtFacts, and let me know, because yeah, I'd like to find out. If you liked what I did, thank you. Go ahead and actually like it on
YouTube.
Reblog it or do whatever you want with it. Share it with your friends. If you really liked it and want to see more stuff like this, go ahead and subscribe. Thank you for watching, and until next time, don't forget to ask questions. All right, bye.